Ladies, gentlemen, our dear audiences, welcome back to the second section of the fifth talk of DXT. And for this upcoming section, we have invited two speakers, and they're going to share with us the tips in removing obstacles in design and technology startup collaboration. And sitting next to me, I think he's the only gentleman speaker for today. He is the founder of Sunbrainer, Mr. Florian Simmendinger, the creator of the world's first wearable smart device, Sunbrainer, for musicians. By combining wearable devices with great software, Sunbrainer creates an addictive music practice experience that allows everyone or anyone to learn, enjoy, and master any instrument. And as of today, they have shipped over 80,000 wearables, and their apps are downloaded by over 500,000 musicians monthly. And today, Florian is going to share with us how to launch a hardware startup by combining great design with modern tech, as well as his entrepreneurial experience, which is how to raise over $1 million on Kickstarter. And without further ado, I think it's now time for me to pass the stage to Florian to tell us more about his experiences and story. So, ladies and gentlemen, Florian, please.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. Great to be here. As we just heard, I'm the founder of Sunbrainer, and I'm going to share today at the example of a Hong Kong-based music tech startup. How did we, out of university, start the company? How did we use design and technology to do that? And how maybe can you do follow in our footsteps and do the same? So I have three main agenda points to give you an idea of our story, our background, give you an example of how such a journey can look like, where you can start, and also the key ingredients to be long-term successful, right? So let's start with who am I and what Sunbrainer does. So at Sunbrainer, as you heard, we're in the world of music making, and we really like to think of making music as a superpower. So you can, for example, captivate a room with music. You can create memories that last a lifetime. You can inspire the world. And as we've just seen, you can even get through a global pandemic thanks to playing music. And that's why so many people in the world wish they would have this superpower and they wish they could play music themselves. But unfortunately, when you actually start doing that, that's kind of how you look like, right? Music practice can be torture. And we want to change that. We want to make music practice addictive through the power of better design and technology. And basically, right now, we live in a golden era for that. If you look at consumer electronics, it's just amazing how fast we're making progress and how design thinking has entered the world of electronics. Yet, if you go to music practice, there are still tools that are literally 200 years old that look like from the Stone Age. And so our starting point as a company was when we graduated from university as degrees in music technology, in design and business, and being musicians ourselves, we said, what instead of this annoying device here, the metronome, what if you could actually, instead of listening to the sound, you could actually feel the rhythm with the vibration, right? Wouldn't that be amazing to feel the beat instead of having an annoying click sound? So in 2016, we launched the Sunbrainer Pulse, and that is a device that can do just that. So instead of listening to a sound, you can feel the beat. And it's also more than just a tool. It's designed as a beautiful watch. And we launched it on Indiegogo. And you may know Kickstarter, Indiegogo, crowdfunding project. And we're actually the second highest campaign in Hong Kong's history with $1.6 million raised in pre-orders. And we shipped all of these units. And all our customers are pretty happy with it so far. And also, next to this hardware, we also have a mobile application for iOS and Android, which is doing pretty well. So we have about 600,000 musicians that use the app every single month and already over 5 million downloads and rapidly growing. So that gives you a bit of context, what my background is, what my experience is, but now how, you know, can that help you and how can you get started? So I think as a designer, if you think about starting a company, even in general, not even just as a designer, there are so many things
you could be doing. There's literally a thousand things, and one of the hardest parts is to figure out what to do. You could design business cards, find an office space, think about your brand, write a business plan, but I would really recommend to not do any of these things, and instead just focus on the most important thing, and that is making something that people want. That sounds very simple and obvious, but in reality, a lot of people get distracted for years with the unimportant stuff. Luckily, that was one of the things we did well from the beginning. And really, like, from like how to make something people want, I would say, you know, there's two ways to design a solution or a product. You can have an amazing piece of technology and think of how could we use this to design a product. And that's really not such a good way, I think. A much better way is to start from a design point of view, where you have a problem and you think of how could we solve this problem and what technology do we need. And that's a really good way to do it. And then really what you want to do is start building a prototype, talking to users, testing the prototype of your users, and then iterating it and going really fast through different iterations. And then at some point, your users and potential customers should be really excited about this product actually coming to life. So this is kind of how the journey looked like for us. You can see here, that's the very first version we built 24 hours after we had the idea. Doesn't look very good. I'm sure you'll agree. You can see it looks pretty rough. And now you might think, what does that have to do with design? Well, design is not just how it looks, but design is also how it works, right? And a big part of the question is, like, for example, where do you want to wear the product? How many vibration motors should it have? How should the vibration feel? These kind of questions, right? And that process is really something very brutal, because you're having a very, very early stage product and you're gonna get pretty negative feedback. So you need to be quite careful to filter that and kind of have the vision and imagination, like what should it be, what would be the feedback if it becomes what it could become, right? But still you need to learn and improve and kind of develop your concept and understanding. So here's a few more photos of our development process, how it eventually improved and improved. At some point, originally we were in Germany. We said, you know, it's very difficult to do this in Germany. Let's actually go to Hong Kong, which we felt like was the best place in the world to build an electronics company. And so we did that, and we figured out in the process what kind of the ultimate vision is that your product should be in the end. And that's really a huge milestone, that you really understand, you know, this is how many buttons it should have. This is the screen technology we want to use. This is the function, and all these really detailed product questions you should know and write a specification sheet. And then you really start thinking about the final visual design, the final engineering, and all these things. So here's kind of that process. So once we knew, we started sketching, we started building more finalized prototypes. We started building, you know, real, like miniaturizing the electronics. And yeah, this is then eventually how the first generation product turned out in 2016. About after 1 year of development, we shipped the product to musicians all over the world. And I have a little quick video to show you some feedback and some reactions that I hope we're gonna see in a second.
No way, man! That is crazy, dude. Oh my God. Can you feel it?
This will not change you being here. This will just add to your music.
I really can't stand the sound of a traditional metronome, and this one's really made for feelers.
The pulse that you feel in your body is part of your system. Can you speak it?
That's the video. So you get a bit of an idea how the final product actually turned out. And so I would say to sum it up, you really, if you're interested in designing your own consumer electronics product, you really have to understand it's a multidisciplinary effort. You cannot just do it alone with design. Obviously, you also need technology, and you also need to have like the marketing sense. It's really like so many different things that need to be combined, which is why it's actually quite challenging and difficult, right? So, and also it's a collaboration process. So you have these competing priorities during product development. For example, as a designer, obviously, let's say you design a watch like we have, you want to make it really small and beautiful, but then you also want it to have great battery life. And so how can you find a visual design that looks great, but that also offers good battery life? And there's all these trade-offs where you really need to closely collaborate with an engineer. And then also from a business and marketing point of view, things like the product cost are very critical. What can we charge in price? How much can we afford in the bill of materials when we manufacture it? Is it manufacturable? All these questions need to be considered. And yeah, it sounds very daunting, but it really, the way you should approach it is come from point of view of what should the final product be like. Once you know that, you can start making, you know, drilling deeper and learning more about those detailed processes. So basically, that's a quick summary of how to get started. And now let's talk a bit about the keys to the long-term success. So I would say if you think about starting a consumer electronics company, as a designer, you should really find a technical co-founder who can help you with the engineering side, because a lot of people have this fantasy they can just outsource the technical implementation and the engineering, but that's not really how it works. In reality, it's an ongoing project, especially when it comes to software. You constantly need to update, improve, build new features, and even like the foundational architecture of the code. A service provider will never build you a good foundation there. So you really want to have your own co-founder on the tech side, which is what I did and what I have seen broadly work with other friends who have started startups. Okay, and something else you just need to be aware of is that you, as a founder of a hardware startup, you will not only be able to work on design. There are so many unpleasant parts of the experience that are also key, like manufacturing and operations and finance and marketing and legal and patents and so many other areas, so that unfortunately today I can spend maybe 20% of my time on design. That's my favorite part of the week. But of course, the other parts are necessary and I also enjoy to a degree. So be aware that if you really want to build this yourself, there's a lot of different areas to figure out. And this also means, by the way, that you need to relentlessly follow the 20-80 rule. If you don't know what that is, it means like with 20% of the effort, you can get 80% of the outcome. And it's really important that you do that in a hardware startup, because there are so many different areas that you don't have time to do anything perfect. And so you really need to figure out what really matters, focus on that, and ignore everything else. That's a key advice I would have. Also, because of this complexity that I'm talking about, it's important you actually find mentors with networks that can help you who've done this before. You need to leave the building. For example, if you're just building Instagram, you can sit in the basement, right? And you can build a whole billion-dollar company. But with hardware, you need to find a manufacturer and much more. So last but not least, I would say as any startup founder, you know, a lot of people think you need startup passion, but really what you need is relentless determination to not give up, because there's going to be a lot of hard times, but also good times. You can kind of think of it as a roller coaster. So I hope that's a quite good overview, quite good introduction. And now you also have the chance to ask a few questions.
Thank you so much, Florian, for sharing your entrepreneurial story with every one of us. Well, actually, after hearing your sharing, I think for the first question, it's the same as a previous speaker, but you're a startup founder. So they would really want to know, because I remember what you've mentioned just now, it's there doing startup, there must be bad times, challenging times, and also sweet, like happy and good times. So how do you think, like, what are the challenges in developing a startup in the Hong Kong environment? Like, is there any specific challenges that you've experienced you can share with us?
I think the special thing about starting a startup is really that there are so many different kinds of challenges, so you can never really be fully prepared for it. Like your key skill as an entrepreneur, I would say, is to figure things out from scratch. Like you just need to be a problem solver, someone who can jump off the cliff and build a parachute on the way down while falling. You know, that's kind of how it feels. So I would say no matter where you do it, in Hong Kong, in Europe, in the United States, there's a unique set of obstacles, but you just have to figure out how to overcome those.
It's a problem-solving skills, but is there any like unique thing that you think the startup may experience in Hong Kong? Or can you name like one or two really memorable challenges that you've faced before?
Sure, yeah. I mean, for example, one key challenge was when we launched on our first crowdfunding campaign, we had these really high expectations for it. We had 20,000 email signups before we launched, and we were dying to know, are we going to make any sales? But with so many signups and so much hype in the music community, we were already celebrating our victory. And then when we actually launched, I still remember we had a big launch party, and then we pressed the button and the sales didn't quite come in, and we thought, well, probably people are still sleeping in other parts of the world. And you know, then finally at like 4 a.m. in Hong Kong, I went to sleep, mm-hmm. right? And woke up at 8 a.m., 9 a.m., and I still remember lying in bed with stomach pain, being scared to check my phone, how much was the real number we had finally sold. And it was like $5,000 worth, which was really low. We were like
much lower
expecting
than your expectation.
100,000, 200,000, something like this. And so it was really like a gut punch to, and we felt really stupid for having overestimated ourselves. But then, yeah, you can't give up, right? You have to. We went back to the drawing board, trying to understand why did no one buy, or just few people? How can we improve it? And we just started grinding and working and improving things. So these are like the, and it worked eventually. So these are like the typical things you deal with: self-doubt, challenges, all that kind of stuff.
So like. Definitely there are lots of roller coaster moments.
Yes.
In creating a startup. And when you see challenges, that definitely you need to have time to sit back and rethink and even redesign the strategies, how to make it a better one. But another question is, it's also about challenges. Maybe people would really want to know about more about your stories. It's like, well, what is the most challenging part when having innovation, like innovation, starting something really new, especially like world's first wearable, it's the metronome, or combining the design and tech together?
Well, yeah, I think one is part of the other, right? Like if you want to develop a new product, you need to combine the tech and the design. And I think, you know, that's, It depends on what exactly you're building, but I would say that is a challenge, but also the fun for me. I love the idea to be able to really think through what would make a great product and overcome all these challenges and be able to make all these decisions and just create the perfect piece of product at the end of the day and holding it in your hands. That's like the best moment. So I think at the end of the day, it's all worth it.
But for last question, well, this is a last minute add-on question. They would like to invite you to share, is there any tips to raise more funds in the crowdfunding project?
Oh yeah, for sure. Like I can write a book about crowdfunding. From the outside, it always seems like, oh, there's a couple of people, they got together, they put together a website and they raised $2 million. But it's more like a month's worth of preparation, and there are many resources online. So you should really look that up and inform yourself. I would say on a very, like the top point, I would say is to just prepare well and have...
Prepare well, it means like pitching or information or product, like what
just like the entire campaign. So for example, it's really key that you're not launching with no community or audience or no one waiting. You can't just put it up and expect it to be a success. You want to, for example, build a website before and test your marketing. Start buying some ads with small budgets, driving traffic to your website. See if people sign up for an email, and then build up a community of people that are looking forward to this product launch. So for example, in our first campaign, we didn't do that, which is why we had such a poor response at the beginning of $5,000 in the first day. But then the second time around, we had a Facebook group that we built of 4,000 musicians that couldn't wait for our product to launch. And so when we pulled the trigger, in the first 3 minutes, we raised $50,000.
Well,
so
much.
The people didn't even watch the video. They were just like, shut up and take my money, right? So that's kind of what you want to work towards. And of course, that takes months to get there. So just do your homework. And you know, there are so many more things to learn about crowdfunding. It's really a big topic, but it's a great start to a company.
Wow, we're so happy to have Florian sharing with us your valuable entrepreneurial experience. I think, well, what's the quote that I may get from you? It's like, learn from experiences. So what Florian shared with us is real life experience in creating a startup. And so if you would like to ask more questions, do feel free to contact Florian. And well, our speakers are definitely very happy to answer all your questions. And at this moment, I would like to say a big, huge thank you to Florian for being here with us and sharing your insightful story with us. Thank you so much, Florian. Thank you.
Thanks for having me. It was great.
Thank you.
See you guys.
And now, after our third speaker, we'll move on to the last speaker of today. 好啦，嗱，轉翻廣東話啦，咁啦，係啦，因為咧，我哋其實咧今日咧都邀請咗好多唔同嘅嘉賓啦，嚟到現場同大家分享噶。咁其實咧，下一位嘉賓咧將會係我哋今次第五場講座嘅最後一位分享嘉賓嚟噶。咁我哋好高興啦，邀請到啦，係從事電信管理超過20年，現任 HTC 香港、澳門以及新加坡嘅總經理。麥紀欣小姐 Jazz 同我哋分享一下 VR 虛擬實境嘅依個產業崛起所面臨嘅挑戰，同時帶嚟嘅一啲新嘅機遇噶。咁其實大家都知道啦，眼見 VR 呢一個咧，絕對係未來嘅一個大趨勢嚟噶。咁 HTC 咧，其實亦都係見到呢一個商機啦，所以佢哋喺全球咧都好積極去致力研發啦、生產同埋提升 VR 裝置，以及推出 5G 嘅智慧型手機嘅。咁同時間啦，阿 Jazz 咧亦都係喺香港、澳門、新加坡啦，加強整合成個 VR 生態嘅系統，去支援創新技術嘅生產啦，同埋推廣 VR 嘅新技術，同時亦都係支持科技同埋設計嘅結合所帶嚟新嘅無限可能性嘅。咁啦。我相信大家對於 VR 呢一個行業都有好多迷思啦，亦都想了解多啲咁，所以咧，我哋今日真係好高興邀請到個 Jazz 咧嚟到現場啦，同大家講多少少噶。所以事不宜遲啦，不如咧，我就將個時間咧交俾我身邊嘅 Jazz 啦，同大家分享一下 VR 呢個產業崛起會帶嚟一啲咩嘅挑戰，同埋一啲咩嘅新機遇。將個時間交俾 Jazz。
Hello， 大家好。今日好開開心咧嚟到呢度咧，同大家分享一下 VR 呢個產業。究竟嚟緊我哋未來呢個趨勢 VR 大家都聽得多啦，大家點樣可以乘住呢個 VR 嘅浪咧，喺度創一番新嘅事業咧？又或者大家會將會面臨一啲咩機遇同埋困難咧？今日都好希望係同大家分享一下嘅。咁其實 VR 虛擬實境究竟呢個市場有幾大咧？根據一個權威嘅雜誌報導啦。估計到咧喺2022年咧，其實 VR 呢個產業包括喺 consumer market 同埋喺 enterprise 嘅 market 咧，個資產淨總值咧可以create 到嘅經濟效益咧，哇！竟然係有大概$270 billion嘅美元。咁喺呢個產業當中，究竟我哋會唔會著重呢個先機，可以都分到一杯羹咧？今日咧我就唔多講 technical。反而我就想同大家分享一下一啲虛擬實境、一啲真實嘅事例同埋個案，究竟而家喺香港做緊啲乜？喺全世界嗰個趨勢又會係點咧？如果你哋係作為一個設計師，又點樣可以喺虛擬實境呢個 VR 產業裏邊作為一個好重要嘅分子咧？其實咧，喺香港咧，其實好多唔同嘅行業啦，佢哋都用緊 VR。但係咧，當佢哋嚟接觸我哋作為一個軟件同埋硬件嘅公司時候咧，其實都會經常問我一個問題嘅喎。呢個問題咧，我到而家都答唔到，就係你哋有冇一啲 VR 嘅設計師可以推薦俾我啊？呢個係一個好好嘅問題， 因為咧原來咧我發現咧香港咧呢個地區咧，雖然咧我哋人才咧仔仔，但係原來咧對 VR 呢個產業或者呢個項目咧，一啲設計師咧仍然係好缺乏嘅。喺度我都想問下大家，作為一個設計師嘅你，有冇玩過 VR 咧？如果你冇玩過 VR 咧，今日可能你就要需要去試下體驗一下，究竟虛擬實境係啲乜嘢啦？其實咧喺香港咧，我諗 VR 咧，喺大約呢五年度咧已經開始興起，特別咧係 5G 喺4月1日已經啱啱開始係推出啦。嚟緊 VR 咧的而且確咧會幫到咧好多各行各業咧，做一啲好多嘅培訓啦、設計啊，甚至乎咧喺一啲零售方面嘅一啲嘅項目嘅。咁而家喺呢個 VR 嘅產業裏邊咧，其實全球裏邊都有五大嘅範疇咧，係好著重 VR， 而且喺個做嘅階段裏邊咧，都已經好成熟。包括有一啲training 嘅訓練啦、設計啦、design 啦、一啲 storytelling 啦，就係譬如話好似喺啲樓盤嘅廣告，佢哋要做一啲虛擬實景，點樣介紹佢個產品俾呢個target customer 啦。另外咧就係一啲 collaboration 啦，譬如我可能係一啲視像會議，將佢變成一啲 VR 嘅conference。特別咧喺呢個疫症期間咧，其實 VR 咧竟然係扮演咗一個好重要嘅角色。啱啱推出咗一個 VR 嘅虛擬實境嘅會議視像嘅application 啦，其實世界好多各地嘅大企業啊都運用得到，而當中設計師咧就要花盡心思咧去了解一下究竟整個內容啊同埋一個應用方面咧，究竟佢點樣去佈置成個虛擬實境嘅設計，特別就仲喺 UI 啦，同埋一個我哋叫 avatar 嘅設計等等。甚至乎咧，香港咧亦都開始陸續咧有好多咧係做緊一啲叫 virtual 嘅 showroom， 尤其是咧係譬如一啲地產嘅行業啦，又甚至乎咧係一啲汽車。你有冇試過咧可以揸住一架法拉利，但係喺虛擬實境裏邊咧可以任意地設計一個你自己喜愛嘅汽車，跟住然之後你係可以喺一個虛擬實境裏邊咧試下飆車。這個已經是發生的了。那麼接下來我們需要在這些行業著重先機的話，首先第一步，作為設計師的你，想一下你自己本身的 expertise， 你的 skill sets 是可以怎樣 match with 這個 VR 的產業了。其實呢在世界各地甚至乎在香港呢，已經剛才我都提到有很多的行業、大機構，甚至乎一個全世界很出名的品牌已經開始利用 VR 虛擬實境呢去做他們的 demonstration， 甚至已經去做 R&D 研發的過程了。我舉一個例子，其實在世界一個 top 5的品牌，一個 B 字頭的一間跑車公司，他們過往如果要設計一個新的跑車的型號是需要18個月，不同世界各地的他們的同事，包括 R&D、設計師、工程系統設計師，甚至乎是零件設計師，他們在世界不同的各地需要各自是運用他們的技巧去做他們的那個部分。但是在這個18個月的過程當中，很多時候是需要做修改，需要做一些 simulation 或者一些模擬的系統的測試等等。設計師最頭痛的就是可能其中一個部門需要改東西的時候，其他的所相關的部門又需要配合。但是我們曾經是幫這間公司去做一個虛擬實境的裝置，令到他們集合到世界各地不同的部門的工程設計師和產品設計師集在一起，他們只需要在虛擬實境裏面用一個 3D 的 modeling， 大家一起已經可以更改那個模式，更改裡面的設計的系統，甚至乎大家是不需要再 travel集合埋一齊咧，就已經可以一齊去討論一個 project。最終咧，由18個月去設計一個汽車新嘅跑車嘅 model 咧，只係需要花6個月嘅時間。所以喺一啲公司裏邊咧，包括喺成本嘅控制啊，設計產品嗰個 product life cycle， 有咗 VR 虛擬實境嘅話咧，其實就會幫到公司咧更加可以發展更多嘅 products 啦，同埋咧係更加有系統，甚至乎咧係更加慳成本嘅。咁喺除咗呢個汽車設計方面咧，一啲室內設計工程啦， 甚至乎我哋可以話係一啲showroom 啊等等嘅設計咧。過往咧，我諗就好多設計師都知道啦，佢哋需要做好多 3D modeling， 甚至乎咧可能要需要咧係搭一啲實景或者係一啲場景。但係透過 VR 咧，不但止咧可以節省呢啲時間，亦都可以咧幫你喺透過你哋做 VR 個模擬實景裏邊咧，可以同客户咧係一齊親身嘅去更改啦，或者係去討論啦，甚至乎係去設計一個全新嘅場景。其實咧，講到設計咧，都包一定會講一定會提及到藝術噶啦。其實 VR 咧喺過往三年裏邊咧，喺香港每年一度嘅盛事咧 Art Basel 裏邊咧，其實好多世界各地嘅藝術家咧，都透過 VR 咧，係將佢哋嘅藝術作品咧呈現出嚟嘅。以前咧，我哋去睇藝術作品咧，通常都會係一啲平面圖，甚至乎可能係一啲古董啦。但你有冇諗過，其實 VR 今時今日，原來一件 VR 嘅作品咧，已經喺市場上邊好有價值。甚至乎疫症嘅期間咧，好多一啲實質嘅conference 或者係一啲嘅展覽咧，都冇辦法咧係可以推行。但係咧，反而就造就咗咧好多一啲虛擬實景嘅 exhibition 咧、conference 咧出現咗啦。我相信好多設計師咧都開始陸續會留意到運用 VR 咧去舉行你嘅設計發布會咧，甚至乎係你嘅設計嘅展覽嘅。其實咧，而家 VR 咧，除咗講技術性嘅層面咧，其實亦都好多時候咧。我哋都會著重佢個設外形嘅設計啦，甚至乎我哋嘅 VR 產品咧，甚至乎亦都係曾經試過咧喺一啲嘅 fashion show 同埋一啲 fashion walk 裏邊咧係曾經出現過嘅噃。試想像一下啦，如果大家喺世界唔同嘅各地，大家一齊參與一場嘅fashion show， 其實呢個都係會係一個盛事嚟嘅。其實而家已經唔係一個虛擬嘅虛構嘅事實嚟㗎啦。其實已經係好多唔同世界各地，特別係巴黎啊、法國嘅羅浮宮啊等等，佢哋都已經係採取咗 VR 咧，係做好多唔同嘅 fashion show 啦。最近咧喺香港咧，我哋啱啱同一啲藝術家，特別咧係香港咧首位嘅極光，就係講北極嘅極光嘅畫師咧攜手合作。其實我哋發現咧，原來好多 VR。嘅創作人咧，佢哋好中意 VR 係因為咩咧？因為個虛擬嘅空間係無限嘅。咁我哋咧就好多發現咗好多人咧，過往咧去做一啲設計咧，都限於喺平面啊，或者喺電腦嘅 3D 構圖。啊，點解我哋唔可以透過一個虛擬嘅實景咧，係將佢變成一個畫廊，甚至乎係一個設計嘅工具咧？咁所以我哋咧最近咧就同香港嘅VR 嘅畫師咧嚇就合作咗咧，推出咗一系列嘅 VR 嘅VR 嘅 art 嘅 design 嘅 course 課程。呢個咧其實亦都係我哋好希望咧着重推廣咧，俾所有嘅設計師佢哋知道咧，透過用 VR 咧，其實呢個一定都唔係一個係好技術層面上邊一個好難切入嘅一個技術嚟嘅。其實VR 本身就是一個以人為本的一個技術，所以設計師咧喺著重去設計嗰個 3D modeling 嘅時候咧，其實中間佢哋係應該要用一個人性化，甚至乎一個人性嘅體驗咧去設計呢個虛擬實景嘅。呢個咧就係最近咧因為疫症嘅影響啦，我相信大家都好多時候都會擔心未來啊，究竟嗰個工作會係點咧？其實而家咧。VR 因為足不出户，亦都唔需要咧有好多唔同嘅connections， 反而咧 VR 咧創造一個營商嘅環境。你可以透過 VR 咧接觸到你嘅 client， 亦都可以透過 VR 咧去建立你嘅作品。咁其中呢個咧，頭先我所講啦，就係透過 VR 咧，你可以舉行自己嘅畫展啦，亦都可以透過 VR 咧係做出好多唔同嘅 VR 嘅作品同埋設計啊等等。呢個都會係一個商機。而家開始咧，陸陸續續咧都好多學校啦，甚至乎機構咧設立緊佢哋嘅 VR 嘅畫室。相信好多設計師做設計師嘅你咧，其實都應該要諗下咧，點樣透過 VR 咧去將你嘅作品咧係呈現俾 client 喎。 呢啲其實都係一啲嘅展品啦。而家啲設計師佢哋去做一啲唔同嘅 avatar 啊，甚至乎係一啲 cartoon 嘅時候，已經再唔係用一啲現時傳統嘅一啲叫 software。而家佢哋咧反而係著重用運用緊好多一啲 VR 嘅軟件咧去設計啦。亦都講到咧，其實好多公司咧都揾我哋咧係做一啲僱員培訓或者是一些特別的技術培訓的訓練，一些設計師呢，特別是一些內容的設計師呢，在香港是非常之頻繁如果是特別是一些的大企業機構，他們可能只是著重一些 IT 的部門，但是在內容編寫和程式編寫，甚至乎是一些 training program 的編寫呢，往往呢這些設計師呢在香港呢是很難找。所以呢，如果大家有一些的對 VR 有興趣的話，其實呢在這個時候呢應該要開始學一下有些哪些的器材，甚至乎呢是一些課程，甚至乎一些軟件呢，它可以將你的設計呢變入去 VR 了。現在呢很多 showroom 剛才我都講過了，很多 showroom 已經開始呢由實體化呢是變成呢是虛擬化了。咁呢個咧，其中一個我哋頭先所講嘅咧，汽車啦，甚至樓盤啦，甚至乎咧，而家買樓咧，都係透過咧虛擬實境咧去做嘅喎。咁呢啲設計師咧，要花盡心思咧，去點樣去設計啦。而喺教育方面咧，亦都係咧，裏邊好多嘅一啲唔同嘅教育內容咧，都需要好多設計師咧去幫手咧去做整個嘅內容嘅設計啊，同埋一個 UI 嘅體驗。咁究竟作為一個設計師嘅你，怎樣跟一些技術的人員，甚至乎一些技術的專門人才去一起去合作，去迎著這個 VR 的產業的浪呢？其實呢，我自己本身呢都不是一個 technical 的人出身，我本身呢都是一個讀 management 的人出身的，但是呢當我投入了 VR 這個產業的時候呢，少不免呢都需要呢是對 VR 產生的過程裡面呢都要有一些技術和技巧的。我會建議各位設計師，其實除了你本身運用的一些的設計軟件之外，其實都需要真的去研究和參考一下一些 VR 的軟件的設計的軟件 的課程，譬如好像 Unity、Unreal 這些，其實在 VR 的製作當課程當中都已經是不可以避免。咁喺你話嚟緊會有啲咩困難呢？困難雖然係大，但係咧機會咧係非常之多。作為一個設計師咧，再唔係單憑咧你有一門嘅技術咧係可以畫圖，或者係可以識得一啲傳統嘅技術嘅軟件。因為好多客户咧，其實佢哋而家需要嘅技術嘅層面方面咧，已經係除咗實體之外咧，仲需要好多虛擬實境嘅一啲嘅 UI 嘅設計啦，甚至乎咧係將一個成個 storyline 嘅鋪排咧，係需要一個設計師咧呈現喺虛擬實境裏邊。虛擬實境裏邊究竟個我哋個客户究竟喺虛擬實境裏邊，究竟佢哋個體驗同埋佢哋嗰個 interactions 究竟會係點咧？其實設計師咧往往係需要咧用代入自己嘅身份咧落去個虛擬實境做個設計。所以如果你今日咧冇試過去玩呢個虛擬實境咧，我希望你咧都可以要的起心肝咧去試下啦。而最後咧，我都好希望咧，各位設計師咧，其實都要除咗 VR 之外咧，都要留意一下，因為我哋而家時代嘅趨勢咧，好多 AI 啊、大數據咧，由客人方面去得到之後咧，其實往往就會將呢一個數據咧，俾設計師咧去安排喺整個嘅產品嘅設計裏邊。所以 AI 啦、VR 啦、XR 啦，將會係成為時代嘅新趨勢。所有嘅設計師，我都希望你哋咧，如果可以嘅話咧，不妨咧多啲咧係運用 VR 嘅創作啦，同埋軟件啦。希望你哋可以幫到我哋嚟緊嘅 VR 整個生態系統咧，係再更加推向高峰嘅。好，我哋今日嘅分享咧，去到呢度啦。
Thank you， 多謝曬 Jazz 嘅分享啦。咁其實咧，剛才咧，Jazz 你除咗都有提及過 VR 之外啦，都話 AI 啦、XR 啦，都係嚟緊未來嘅大趨勢嚟嘅。咁咧，我剛才咧就見到有啲朋友啦，就有問，其實就係話嗱，譬如好似你話你哋 HTC 啦，其實都係越嚟越致力去開發 VR 呢一個技術同埋呢個市場。咁有朋友就話啦，咁其實市場上面有咁多大公司，去即係發展 VR 呢一個技術， 咁其實啲初創公司會唔會好難可以同大公司喺呢一個 VR 嘅市場入面去並存咧？
啊，我成日都覺得咧，我都會同好多初創公司嘅有啲叫 startup 公司嘅 CEO 啦去傾偈嘅。我哋咧係好著重鼓勵咧好多 startup 公司同我哋一齊合作，因為喺我哋自己本身咧，我哋作為 HTC 嘅員工咧，每一日啊都會覺得自己係個 startup。因為 technology 咧係未有成熟嘅一天嘅，永遠我哋都會用一個心態，就係自己本身都係 startup。咁其實香港咧好多機遇，咁我亦都喺度呼籲咧，其實如果有好多一啲 startup 嘅公司，特別佢哋好致力投身於喺 VR 同埋設計呢個行業裏邊咧，不妨主動嚟揾我，我揾緊你哋
好似剛才咧 ，Jess 你都有講過一開始分享嘅時候，你講話啊，成日都有人問你一個問題，就係點樣有冇啲好嘅 VR 設計師介紹？
我而家都未答到。
所以其實真係我諗真係。設計師都可以看看怎樣去知道這個趨勢與時並進的。但是我記得剛才你說你們看大公司都是一個 startup， 因為好像你其實你的出身都是management 出身，做技術這樣的。但是其實可以對於初創公司來說，你說其實都看到這個 VR 生態系統是有很多的機遇。咁你睇其實喺香港呢個環境入面，其實對於一啲 VR 嘅初創公司有啲乜嘢嘅機遇或者好嘅條件俾到佢哋咧？
其實咧機遇非常之多，特別咧係政府最近咧係投放好多嘅 IT 嘅資金同埋資源咧，俾一啲嘅初創公司啦，甚至乎係一啲中小企嘅公司，特別喺一個科研同埋技術嘅設計方面咧，投下好多資金嘅。咁所以好多初創公司咧，其實佢喺一開波嘅時候，最擔心就係資源同埋錢啦，因為你需要買器材咧，需要去學啦。但係其實我可以話俾大家聽咧，你上一個政府網頁裏邊，你睇到有好多funding嘅。其實呢個亦都可以幫助緊好多初創公司咧，係去利用呢啲資源咧，去 get prepare。所以我覺得我哋會同好多唔同嘅 startup 公司咧，去幫佢哋去 apply funding 嘅。所以我覺得其實如果你哋有興趣的話咧，其實真係唔好嘥咗呢啲資源。
咁即係都可以咁講，其實資源咧都喺香港都係其中之一嘅優勢啦。咁有一位朋友就想問啦 ，VR 呢個技術咧，尤其係好需要科技同埋設計互相配合，即係 exactly 好似我哋 DXT 咁樣。咁將設計嘅概念解釋翻俾一啲technical 嘅人再去做啦，但係當中會唔會遇到特別多嘅困難？因為兩個完全即係唔同嘅 background 啦，簡稱嚟講，佢諗緊其實會唔會有好多雞同鴨講嘅情況發生咧？
其實咧，每一間初創公司根據我所見到嘅經驗咧，通常一間初創公司都有兩個好大嘅主流嘅人咧，一定要成立呢間公司嘅靈魂人物，一個咧。就是講緊一個 UI 嘅一個 design， 純粹係虛無縹緲嘅嚇，佢可以講乜都得，
天馬行空嘅，
就 concept creation。OK， 另外一個咧要落地啲嘅，就係 ontological， 真係點樣將一個天馬行空嘅技術咧喺技術層面咧將佢變成一個演繹。咁你問我，即係針冇兩頭嚟嘅，一個就從事 design， 一個咧就從事 technical， 係咪雞同鴨講咧？其實。
都有啲困難嘅，
有啲困難嘅。但係如果係一個嘅設計師嚟講，佢哋知道咧，哦，基本一啲技術嘅技巧咧，其實唔難嘅，亦都唔需要花好多時間。佢會了解得到咧中間兩個平衡點嘅。所以 technical 嘅人，佢哋未必可能一開始已經懂得從事去 design， 因為佢哋真係寫 program 嘅。但 designer 咧 ，somehow 咧，我覺得佢哋可以多少少嘅 technical background 啦，可以即係將成個 gap 咧去 bridge 咯。所以我覺得譬如好似我咁啦，我都想去學嘅嚇，因為原因就係我想知道多啲，令到個 implementation 會快啲咯。
咁即係譬如了解嗰樣嘢多啲嘅時候，可能同團隊溝通啊。都會更加容易。
係，我見到好多成功嘅 startup 公司咧，通常咧佢哋個 CEO 嘅轉變咧，都係一個堅尼地嘅嚇，變咗比較腳踏實地一啲嘅嚇。咁呢個係中間個我哋見到嘅過程咧，佢係需要咧係融合喺嗰個 VR 嘅技術層面方面，但係一啲都唔難。可能你只係需要花三個月至半年嘅時間，其實你 學會 VR。
嗯，即係個技術部分其實
冇錯，
大家即係可能設計或者比較堅尼地嘅人，其實學翻一啲比較貼地嘅諗法同埋溝通，
冇錯，
咁令到成件事會更加容易行。咁但係講起 start up 咧，我就諗起一條問題，就話其實有冇一啲 tips 俾一啲 VR 嘅 start up 公司喺香港嘅？其實應該由邊一方面開始入手啊？點樣做起咧？如果係嘅話？
其實咧做 startup 公司咧，首先我覺得佢哋要有堅毅，因為其實你 VR 係一個我哋會講係一個 pick up， 亦都係一個二十年嚟講一個大浪嚟嘅，即係喺二十年前可能就係手提電話，二十年嘅今日之後咧，其實就係 VR 一個5G。OK， 咁 startup 公司咧，其實好多人都會話啊，其實而家個市場個 size 有幾多咧？咁佢哋需要 evaluate 就係佢哋有啲咩人手啊，有咩資源啊，啊需唔需要好大嘅地方咧？咁我自己會覺得咧，首先一間 startup 公司咧，佢需要去 identify 咗你係應該係做一啲乜嘢嘅 vertical market， 一啲乜嘢嘅 segment。喺香港咧 ，education 啦。healthcare 啦、training 啦等等一啲唔同嘅 industry 咧，其實已經係跑咗出嚟嘅啦。所以我諗 startup 公司咧，佢初初入手嘅時候咧，佢要 identify 一個佢哋嘅 industry 嚇 ，make up 佢哋一個 professional knowledge， 呢個係先最重要。所以我覺得 startup 公司咧，不妨咧做一啲 research 啦，甚至乎咧係可以。同我哋一齊去分享一下啊！我哋好願意 去分享呢個市場嘅個資訊同埋過程嘅。咁所以我諗最重要嘅 startup 公司就係最重要一開始嘅時候都需要一個堅毅，因為做 VR 開波嘅時候係好難，但係當你設立咗一個團隊同埋有呢個 connection 嘅時候咧，訂單係陸續而嚟。
嗯，我記得頭先阿 Jazz 咧喺分享入面都講咗 VR 咧應用，可以話而家日常應用就五大範疇。咁其中有幾個我記得好似 training 啦，一啲 storytelling 啦，或者 collaborations
啊，係好多。
係咁，所以咧啊，大家不妨有咩諗法嘅啊，都可以咧，真係歡迎。或者一問題，尤其好似阿 Jazz 咁講，我聽得最多就係歡迎同佢交流嘅。
冇錯，因為我哋最需要嘅就係設計師專業嘅人才。去幫我哋做 VR 嘅 content。
咁其實又諗下，如果而家係身為設計師嘅你啊，見到如果 VR、AR、XR 係一個未來嘅大浪嘅時候，會唔會可以趁機把握呢個機會去將自己更加與時並進咧？又可以留俾你哋諗下啦。嗱，好啦，我同阿 Jess 傾偈咧，就傾到呢度先啦。咁但係其實咧，我哋一陣間咧，仲會有我哋今日第五場講座嘅第二個環節，就係我哋 Rapid Fire 嘅時段啦。咁咧。都提一提啦，如果咧我哋係未填問卷嘅朋友咧，就可能麻煩啦，都趁而家呢一分鐘嘅時間咧，就幫我哋填一填翻份問卷先嘅，因為咧我哋都好想藉住呢個機會咧，去了解一下你哋嘅諗法㗎。咁你哋想填問卷咧，就好簡單 ，scan 一 scan 啦，喺我哋 Facebook 貼文下面留言位置嗰個 QR code 啦，或者 click 翻嗰條 link 咧，就可以去到我哋嗰個問卷嗰度㗎啦。好，俾一分鐘時間，大家填一填問卷先，一分鐘後翻嚟我哋第二部分嘅環節，一陣見。Hello， 咁多位觀眾，歡迎大家咧翻到嚟我哋 DXT 第五場講座第二個環節，就係我哋 Rapid Fire 嘅時段啦。咁其實咧，我哋呢個 Rapid Fire 時段咧，就係咧早前啊經過報名咧 Joy 而被選中嘅公司啦，佢哋將會有兩分鐘嘅時間去介紹佢哋自己公司嘅資料、現有嘅產品同埋服務。咁之後咧，最重要啦就係當然分享一下究竟 DXT 呢一個平台可以點樣真真確確咁樣幫到佢哋嘅公司。業務發展係話更具潛力之餘咧，亦都更上一層樓噶。咁今日咧，我哋邀請到兩間公司咧嚟到我哋 Rapid Fire 時段咧，同大家介紹一下佢哋嘅公司資料啦、產品啦、佢哋嘅技能啦，咁亦都睇下啊，究竟。可以透過 DXT 嘅平台點樣做到更加多嘅配對㗎？咁坐喺我隔離嗰位咧，就係代表 ZLAM.co 嘅 Miss Zita Lam。咁不如啦，嗱，究竟 ZLAM.co 做啲乜嘢嘢 ？Zita 想揾啲咩嘢嘅專才咧？我將個時間交俾 Zita 同我哋講下。
好 ，thank you。Hello， 大家好，我係 Zita。咁我就為咗呢個 rapid fire 嘅 session 咧，咁就做咗一個少少嘅 opening。咁首先咧就要多謝 DXT 啦，俾呢個機會我嚟到呢度同大家講幾句嘅。好，咁呢個係咪好似一個產品發布會咧？其實咧，我見大家咧就好似一個 virtual meetup 咁樣。咁你唔知我係邊個，亦都唔知你係邊個啦。咁就希望咧， 好好在呢度同大家介紹一下我自己嘅。咁我係 Sita 啦，咁我就係有 video production 同埋 graphic design background 嘅 motion designer。咁通常大家聽到 motion designer， 咁 motion design 係乜嘢咧 ？graphic design 就聽得多啦。咁 motion design 你咁樣睇到我呢、這個你咁樣睇到我呢個嘅 layout， 咁可能就會話啊，你正講緊 UI UX 啊。咁其實唔一定嘅喎 ，motion design 咧仲可以幫到好多嘢，例如 prototype 啦，好多樣唔同，只要 involve 到 motion 嘅咧，我都有可能幫到你噶。咁例如我舉三個簡單嘅例子啊，第一個 logo animation， 大家 logo 就成日都會放喺唔同嘅地方啦。咁其實 digital platform 入邊咧，咁如果簡單一個 logo 佢識喐嘅話咧，亦都可以令到 catch 到大家嘅 attention 嘅喎，咁就例如好簡單一個 N 字，然後聽到噔噔，係咪即刻諗到係時候超下咧？我嘅意思係咧，睇下 drama， 睇下劇咁樣，係啦。咁另外一個第二樣嘢，我想同大家講下咧，就係一個 explainer video 啦。咁點解 explainer video 咧？咁例如你出咗個 app 啦，咁我想audience 知道更加多究竟呢件嘢係乜嘢一回事啊？咁如果可以加入呢個 motion graphic 咧，又或者一啲information， 咁你嘅 audience 一定唔可以錯過你嘅 service 又或者 product 啦。咁第三樣嘢就係 title sequence 啦。咁乜嘢係 title sequence 咧？其實佢喺 motion design 入邊咧就係一個大佬嚟嘅喎。點解我會咁講咧？咁大電影大製作咧會有呢個嘅 title sequence 做一個開場啦。咁你有可能成為呢個科技巨頭，可唔可以咁講咧 ？Tech giant。咁當然唔少得都可以整翻一個 title sequence for 你嘅 live video 嘅一個 opening 啦，又或者一個 YouTube channel 嘅一個 opening 都可以嘅喎。咁呢三樣嘢就係少少嘅 motion design 嘅一個 examples 啦，但係我相信其實仲有好多範圍，只要你諗到嘅有 motion 嘅，亦都可以同我 match up 一下。咁當然見到呢、這個，希望你係我係你嘅 right person 啦。咁係啦，希望同你 match up 一下。咁 online 嘅你可以去我嘅 website zlam.co， 又或者去 LinkedIn zlam 就可以揾到我噶啦。咁 thank you， 多謝大家。
Thank you， 多謝曬 Sita 同我哋分享啦，佢嘅專業嘅技能喺邊度？咁當然啦，佢都分享咗就係咧，凡係有 motion 嘅嘢咧，佢都應該幫得到你嘅。咁所以咧，如果咧你哋想揾 Sita 咧去傾下多啲合作嘅可能性啦，不妨咧去 zlam.co 啦，我驚 call 佢哋未必聽得到啊，係啦 ，zlam.co 啦，或者咧去 LinkedIn 嗰度揾Sita Lam 就 OK 噶啦。喺度咧，再一次多謝曬 Sita 今日嘅分享先啦 ，thank you 多謝曬。咁其實咧，大家都知道我哋 Rapid Fire 呢個時段啦，就好希望真係邀請到一啲唔同嘅設計師啦，或者科技嘅專才，透過呢個平台啦，去講佢哋嘅技能之外啦，介紹佢哋嘅產品啦，亦都啦睇下可以點樣透過我哋呢個平台咧，做到一個好似一個即係 speed dating 嘅一個諗法，可以咧將設計師啦同埋科技專才啦，做到一個更加多嘅融合㗎。咁剛才我都話啦，我哋今日咧邀請到兩間公司嘅代表嚟到現場㗎，咁所以其實咧，而家咧，我身邊咧已經，突然間咧轉咗一位公司嘅代表啦。咁其實咧，佢就係代表 BNetTech Company Limited 嘅 Mr. Brian Lam。咁 Brian 咧，你見到咧，佢就帶住佢哋公司嘅產品，就係一個手杖，係啦，拐杖手杖，睇下佢陣間點介紹。不如嗱，我就唔講咁多啦，將個時間交俾 Brian 同我哋講啦。
好，你好，我係 Brian 啦，係BNetTech Company 嘅 Brian。好，其實係啦，頭先啱啱。主持都講到，其實我哋而家應該都要習慣下，應該要改叫手杖，因為我覺得咁嘅拐杖咧有少少負面咁解嘅。因為我哋其實好似 DXT 咁啦，其實我哋而家我哋technology 同埋 design 其實根本上係 going forward， 一定要繼續去兩個嘢結合。其實我覺得簡直係天衣無縫嘅。任何嘅 technology 其實冇 design 咧，好似我哋嘅客户群其實主要嘅使用者係一個長者嘅咁。我哋如果淨係單單俾 technology 佢咧，其實好多時就會忽略咗究竟佢點樣去使用嘅。因為 長者好多時咧，好比較大家都知道佢哋比較抗拒使用一啲鬼高科技嘅產品啦嚇。咁你話俾佢啊點樣使用嗰個拐杖，話好方便理解好多功能噶，大家都會覺得佢會係唔好啦，好煩啊！我連電話都唔識用，咁點樣去搞咧？咁樣咁所以咧，其實我哋在 technology 的時候，其實我們都會加入了很多 design 的元素，甚至乎在物料啊、顏色啊，還有它 even 是一個很小的問題，可能大家都會覺得喂智能產品有電的，那要插電啦，是不是？很簡單，你加了下去，你就給個長者去充電咯，那沒有電就不可以用的啦，是不是？電話都是。但是就是一個小小的問題，其實長者可能你就要想一下他可能看東西視力又衰退啦，到這麼小的 USB 洞插下去其實是很困難的，所以呢其實我們就會特別連充電的時候都會考慮回給一個特別的充電座，他可以用一個就這麼磁吸式吸下去，那他們需要用的時候只要一拿出來那他就可以使用的了。那變成最主要就是因為如果他們連充電都解決不到，我相信他可能捱得那三四日可能他已經放低，因為經常忘記充電，經常忘記用電，拿回普通拐杖就不會用了。所以我們要由一個很細緻，他們由個使用感覺其實都是像之前我們做 Even 做 IT 那邊 UX UI， 其實都是一個 UX 來的，因為它是一個使用的習慣來的嘛。如果你不能夠去設計到給他去使用那個產品適當呢，咁佢哋都唔會用嘅，所以咧，你見到我哋，就算我哋有好多 function 咧喺入邊，其實可以睇下我哋有五大功能喺度嘅。咁其實我哋啲功能咧，主要咧就係會由一個感應器去控制啦，咁會有一個光控啦，咁其實我哋有啲 sensor 係加咗入邊。咁最主要，所以咧就希望個長者咧就完全唔需要去學習啲拐杖嘅，基本上好似用翻普通嘅時候一個手杖咁樣去出街。咁佢需要咩咧？需要燈嘅時候，咁其實去到暗嘅地方，我哋會俾佢啦。需要暖嘅時候，我哋嘅手柄咧會發熱嘅，咁可以提供到個温暖俾佢啦。若然佢唔小心跌低咗嘅，咁其實我哋就會幫佢去做一個通報，去話翻俾個聯絡人聽啦。咁有電話嚟到喎，咁我哋呢個手柄就會一個來電震動提佢喎。咁所以咧，其實佢嘅使用咧，就希望佢成個體驗咧就係一個普通去使用嘅拐杖，唔好去考慮啲科技點樣咁煩啦。咁所以咧。其實是一個將希望真係將設計同埋一個 technology， 唔係淨係俾即係年青人啊，或者嚟緊一啲用家。咁其實長者我哋都唔可以忽略嘅，因為其實我哋就係需要正正需要設計一啲科技嘅產品嚟方便佢哋，同埋或者保障佢哋一啲咁嘅安全咯嚇。咁所以其實我哋覺得呢個平台都會DXT， 我諗我哋頭先見到啲 guest 啊speaker， 其實我哋。我都會覺得很多synergy 都會發生到，就是因為design 是沒有一個完美的產品的。其實第二代、第三代，其實我們可能繼續都會有一些新的功能，譬如我們會加一些MBIOT 啊，新的 5G 的技術上去，變成我們都會需要繼續改良，那個產品的外形啊，那些東西都可以繼續，因為其實我們，雖然我們全部設計和科技都是我們自己 去一手包辦，叫做，但是在設計生產的設計方面，其實我覺得我們比較弱的一環，因為我們可能集中在外形、科技，但往往就是在那個生產的時候遇到比較大的 challenge， 所以電子、mechan 要放在一個這麼小的環境底下，其實就是正正即係需要在有專業的生產線咧，去俾多啲 input 我哋啦。咁所以如果 online 嘅你，大家若然會有很多咁嘅 comment， 其實很多人見到呢支手杖，可能都會有很多咁嘅comment。究竟會唔會有啲功能可以再 improve 啊？咁其實我哋都 feel free， 大家一齊可以再 cross over 咁樣。
咁係因為咧，呢一支智能手掌啦，都係第一代嚟嘅。咁好似剛才 Brian 你講，其實都會再改良啦，進化去到第二、第三代。咁當然你哋可能嘅樽嘅話就係希望啦，可以揾到一啲 manufacturing 生產方面比較技術性嘅專才去幫你哋將你哋諗到嘅嘢點樣可以
擠到曬入去咧，從而優化咗。咁但係咧，我自己本身都覺得其實你嘅產品咧嗰、那個Stiku 啦，呢一個智能手杖都已經係一個好好嘅 DXT 嘅一個例子嚟㗎咯。設計同埋科技嘅融合就係、是、點樣去顧及一個 UI 啦、UX 嘅一個體驗啦，亦都將即係美觀嘅技術都融合於一身㗎。咁喺度咧，再一次多謝曬 Brian 嘅介紹先啦。